I was born and raised in Southall. This is my town. This is where I've grown up. This is where my parents taught me everything I know, and this is where I went to school.
I was mainly interested in taking part in the project because I wanted to find out the history of the Southall Youth Movement. My father took part in it, he was a participant. He had a really active role, so I wanted to see how it was like and the struggles he went through.
My granddad was involved in the Southall Youth Movement, where he wasn't part of it, but he contributed in marches, and he had been in fights at the National Front.
This project is more than just making a documentary, learning how to film. It was more about being able to keep a piece of history going.
My parents told me many stories about riots that happened in Southall in the late 70s and the early 80s, and the atrocities that my community, the Asian community, had to face at the hands of groups like the National Front.
I think one of the biggest reasons why I got involved in this project is because during the 1970s, my father also came from Tanzania and moved straight into Southall. So I am aware of some of the racism that he was faced with during that particular period of time.
To have teddy boys in those days. I don't know if anybody remembers the teddy boys. They used to go around and picking on the Asian community, beat them up and take their wages away from them. So that's the sort of a memory I have when I first moved into Southall.
That a lot of our parents suffered from discrimination, plus the jobs, they had to take lowly paid jobs in order to make ends meet. There was discrimination in the workforce. I used to remember my father telling me how the English used to treat the Asian workforce with contempt, fights with foremen giving the worst jobs to the Asians.
ਤੇ ਜੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੇ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਕੰਮ ਤੇ ਜਾਂ ਗੋਰੇ ਨੇ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਬੁਰਾ ਭਲਾ ਵੀ ਕਹਿ ਲੈਣਾ ਤੇ ਮਾਈਂਡ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਕਰਦੇ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਵੱਡੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸੀ ਤੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਗਾਹੇ ਬਖਾਏ ਆਪਣੇ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਜਾਂਦਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਮਾਰ ਵੀ ਪੈਂਦੀ ਸੀ ਰੇਸ਼ਸ ਅਟੈਕ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਜਿਹਨੂੰ ਅਸੀਂ ਕਹਿ ਦਿੰਦੇ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਤੇ ਈਵਨ ਸਾਡੇ ਲਾਗੇ ਲਾਗੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਈ ਸਾਊਥਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਵੀ ਕਈ ਪੱਬ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਜਾ ਸਕਦੇ ਉੱਥੇ
When we came here, it was absolutely culture shock because the second day I met a friend of mine who'd come here 6 months before me, I got attacked outside the Southall police station by a bunch of skinheads. They just beat us up right outside the police station, and nobody did anything about it. And that's when my whole kind of, thoughts about being in England changed overnight. And I said to my friend, "What's this all about?" He says, "Get used to it, mate."
Uxbridge Park, we wouldn't go down Dane Road, or National Front down that area. We'd all, a group of us, would go that way. But if that group was in the park, we'd come home. And dad, mum and dad would always say, "Oh, tini yana, hey, tini yana, don't go here, don't go there."
And I remember instances where the police would pick on four or five of us and put them in a van and take us to Watford. Even when the M25 was in build, they said, "Right, walk it back, you packies." Serious, this is happening to us all the time.
Going to school, I mean, almost a totally different environment where I didn't understand any English at all. After a bit of time, for some reason, I got sent from one school to another. And I later discovered that the reason was that there were basically too many Asians in that one school, because I used to see some white parents shouting. I didn't realize they were shouting against us. Later on, I discovered that they were actually picketing Beaconsfield Junior School because they didn't want all these Asians coming into that one school. That was a precursor for what became known as busing, as dispersal, which meant my mother had to get up at about 6:30, take my sister to a coach pickup point, and, you know, almost 50, 100 coaches would descend on Southall, and they were dispersed, these Asian children were dispersed all over the borough of Ealing. Not one white child was ever bussed into Southall.
My mum and dad shipped me off to a school in Acton. I think that's where it really hit me, catching a 207 all the way to Acton in them days. White people would come up that were bigger than you, skinheads. You'd look at their red boots and you think, oh, shit, I don't need this. You just put your head down and you get smacked across the back of your head, you know. Oi, Packy, get off the bus. What are you doing upstairs? This, just grin and bear it, really. You know, it was hardship. I was one of, what, the only Indian out of about 1,600 people. Every day I'd get beaten up by white people.
I was interested in playing football. I went for the school trials. This is when I was about 10. I ran and I ran and I ran. Nobody ever passed the ball to me. And I was the only Asian. In fact, I was the only black kid in that thing. And it was the trials were in the playground. And I remember the disappointment. I was so hurt with this kind of experience. I decided that I was never going to play for any school, ever.
The school they sent me to was in Hanwell, Brentside. There wasn't much Asians there. I think in my year there must have been about 4 or 5 of us, that's it.
Everybody in their spare time used to write lines. I must not speak Punjabi in class. And I could do it with 3 pencils held together. We used to mass produce them because one or the other of us would always get this sentence.
Getting beaten up every day. Called names you've never heard of before. You know, getting spat at dinner time. People walking past, spitting your food. And like, it was just terrible.
There was no policeman there to help you, no council person. There was no elder leadership there to help you. Once you crossed that school path, you were by yourself. You had to run to catch a bus, and you were being kicked. And you had people chasing you while you wanted to run to catch a bus.
We was young, we formed a gang. And like, what the skinheads were doing us, like there was shout, you know, we're going packy bashing today, we're going packy bashing today. So we was going skinhead bashing. Because most of the time, at night time, they, you know, they'll come in cars and everything, like, you know, just to swear at us and find somebody on his own and beat him up. But then, like, you know, there was quite a few of us, so we just stood around corners with bottles and bricks, and when you see the cars come in, let it go.
I remember it blatantly by the huts, coming out of class, all these white people just jumped and started beating me up. And there was another Jamaican boy with me, I remember him blatantly. Terry Wells, his name was. And he said, come on, banger, get up, man. So we all started getting into a bit of a frackle with these guys and that, these kids, school kids as he was, and he ran off and I thought, oh, that's nice. But what he did 2 minutes later, he came back with a load of Jamaican black people, and you know what, we had such a big scuffle, and we had a laugh and a joke about it. And I just became friends with him.
Because our parents taught us, like, don't answer back. You know, respect everyone. But we were getting to a stage where we were being physically or unphysically abused every day, going to school and this, calling names. And we just, you know, we were coming to a stage where we said, you know, why? But when you went home, our parents would say, police is right, the teachers is right, everyone is right, you mustn't say anything. Just turn the other cheek and come home.
remember going to school on the bus one day. We were going past Ealing Hospital, was just getting built. I remember some Sikh boy, some skinheads collared him and they scarred him up, you know. I remember it, reading about it, and everybody telling me they scarred him with a Stanley blade, put an F on his back and all this. And that's when I was thinking, hold on, guys, we need to stop here. That could be me or somebody else. The clock was ticking, I think, at that time. You know, especially when that chap got murdered and Chaggar. I think everybody was the wall of silence when I said, hold on, these guys are taking the piss now.
Gurdeep Chaggar was a Sikh boy, and I think he was murdered down Featherstone Road. We just heard that a boy has been killed the following day after, you know. The word got through Southall that they've started killing people now, you know.
And it just hit us, really. It could be any of us that could have happened to. And I remember that time we all quickly got up, like my brothers and also my cousins, all of us all went. And all of a sudden, we had 30, 40 people congregating all together, went to the area to have a look what happened. And from there, it did feel a bit, we felt like we got to do something.
Then I remember next day, at the Dominion Cinema, with a public meeting taking place, where there's slight chaos, but a lot of people trying to organize themselves, what should be done. And as people come out of Dominion Cinema, four people, I think, got arrested. I'm not sure the exact number. And then massive amount of people outside the Dominion Cinema marching on to the police station because four people had been arrested.
And that's where Southall Youth Movement started, actually, from that Dominion meeting. Because all the groups got together, and then eventually we had more meetings after that. And that's why, virtually, put it this way, all the rebel kids in Southall got together.
At that time, the community came together. You know, the community shared Mrs. Chaggar's grief. And I still remember her crying, you know, and it's really, you know, we went to the funeral and everything, we saw the body. I remember Suresh, Balraj was one of the coffin bearers as well. And when we saw him lying there, it really hurt, you know. So unnecessary, you know.
But I never thought that they would attack these men. So when I got to know that these men had murdered these men, then I opened my eyes and opened my eyes and opened my eyes that these men had to keep their young people in their lives. ਗਾਂ ਜੇ ਪ੍ਰਫੁੱਲਿਤ ਹੋਣਾ ਆ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਜਿਸ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਮਰਡਰ ਕਰਕੇ ਜਿਸ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਸਿੱਟ ਕੇ ਗਏ ਸੀ ਉਹ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਆਮ ਬੰਦਾ ਦੇਖਦਾ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਦਾ ਖੂਨ ਖੋਲ ਉੱਠਦਾ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਯਾਦ ਹੈ ਜਿੱਦਾਂ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਮਰਡਰ ਕਰਕੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਫੈਂਸ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਸਿੱਟ ਕੇ ਗਏ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਯਾਦ ਹੈ ਉੱਦਾਂ ਜ਼ਰਾ ਪਿਆ ਦਿਸਦਾ
The Southall Youth were the forum for our voice, and we were very vociferous. We said, look, we want action, we want to do something. And I remember that. All I remember is that Uncle Rai and the elders of the community, they basically said, no, we can't go about it like that. We have to, you know, find out the facts. They told the softly approach. They were the more Georgia. We wanted war.
It was a big moment for Southall Youth Movement. The kind of anger that burnt underneath the surface was because of Chaggar's murder, right?
I mean, I think the response of young people to Gurdeep's murder is a pivotal and central and seminal moment in race relations history in this country. It's the first time that a community led by young people send a very clear message that they are not willing to tolerate racist murders and violence in their towns.
We knew that nobody was going to listen. In fact, the first thing they did was to discount it had any racial motivation. A lot of young people objected, protested, resisted and wanted action. During those early days, a couple of our friends were arrested. And they got taken into the police station. And so all the young people mobilized. They put Southall Police Station under siege. Southall Police had never experienced something like this in an organized sense. They called in the community leaders. And the community leaders, what they did was, they did a deal with the police. They went into the police station and said to these guys who were arrested, they put pressure on them to say, you know, you're going to get a record. What do your family going to think? This, that, and the other. You go outside and you tell people you haven't been charged. We will do a deal with the police and make sure you're not charged. So these guys came outside of the police station and said, we haven't been charged. That was a tactic to disperse the siege of the police station. It became apparent that the leaders had sold us all down the drain, that actually these people were going to be charged, even though they'd sort of said they weren't. And that was the pivotal moment where Southall Youth Movement was formed.
The older generation, the one that sort of was before our generation, had already tried to do something about the situation here, because, you know, you probably know the story of the Indian Workers Association, Dominion Cinema, collecting the money, the strikes and so on. So they were trying to really sort of, you know, organize themselves. The Gurdwara was there and so on and so on. But they were in kind of, we have to survive this mode. Our generation came along and said, we have rights, you know, and we want those rights, right, honored. And if we don't, we're going to do something about it.
The volcano was starting to erupt. The lava was boiling. We were boiling. We were getting angry. And we just wanted to find out, and we just wanted justice for Gurdeep.
We had the history of those people who had physically defended us at school, or were continuing to do that. We knew that some people were in working now, and they were kind of active in the workplace.
The groups that formed together were, we had groups called the Holy Smokes, we had groups called the Tutinangs, and we had sports people playing kabaddi, groups from them, and we had people in colleges, came around from Brunel University up in Uxbridge. Mr. Harpal Gill was the organizer there.
There was almost a representative from each one. And that became the core of Southall Youth Movement. And it was like a collective in the sense. And it was up to each individual to kind of pass the message to their particular group. So we had at our disposal at any time at least about 600 people.
And I got a job with something called the National Association for Asian Youth, which was based in Southall on the High Street. And I was supposed to be, because I was educated and stuff, then I was supposed to be working in the kind of structured, formal sector. But I got ambushed. I got ambushed by a guy called Balraj Purewal and Gurmel Brar, who came along and said, "Oi, what are you doing with these guys? They don't know anything about what's going on here. They don't know anything about young people. Come with us." And so they kind of needed somebody who could, you know, talk the language and write the reports and do the sort of credible playing the system stuff whilst they were on the streets. They were really trying to get some kind of facilities going. We had a broken down old building which we were squatting, 12 Featherston Road, and it was falling down around our ears, but we sort of did enough work to keep it going, open it up as a youth center, because there weren't any youth centers in Southall at the time. The borough council just wasn't interested. It was that center that really drove us, that we wanted to create something there, have a sort of way of looking after our kids at the same time.
Southall Youth Movement was set up in Old Southall, Featherston Road. They also set up an Indian Youth Club, which is at Tudor Road School, just off the Broadway, Tudor Road. Now, we'd go to Southall Youth Movement. We'd learn photography. We'd learn the history of where our parents were. We know about the Gurdwara, the temples. We learn about things like music. There's a music room. We'd learn how to record digital sounds. In them days, you know, recording studios and everything. Misty and Roots were born and brought up there. Big, major Jamaican band now. We used to go there to pass the time, any advice we need. If we were picked on at school, I remember saying to Diggs, you know what, I'm getting kicked in at school. Where's your school? Acton County, blah, 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 Reynolds High School. These guys used to take me to school sometimes, bring me back. And it was a place where, you know what, we could go as a unity and sit, get to know everybody, the old school boys, you know, us guys, you know, have a laugh and a joke. And it was our little movement.
You know, it was becoming very political as well, the youth movement. It was a forum for speech for the youth, basically. All our grievances went through Southall Youth Movement at that time.
We used to get our hands dirty, paint the place, you know, just make it sparkly. We had something to do. You know, we had something to do, and it was like, oh, we got to go. Forget school, I'm going to sit at SY and bunk off and sit there. Used to get told off, what you're doing there? Get your ass into school.
If you're not in work, you could go there and get advice. Benefit-wise, there are only certain things that you needed.
We used to play Bangla music, you know, before Bangla became popular, right? And it was our version of reggae, right? So the Jamaican kids had reggae. We had this sort of Bangla that we were mixing around with. And before you knew it, it was huge.
Football, we wanted to be allowed to play football. So we had to take a whole army with us, so that we could enjoy 90 minutes of pleasure and skill and lose and win, whatever the thing was. That's all we dreamt about. So we formed our own team. We were a brilliant side. Because we were always one of the top sides, every match there would be monkey chances, usual stuff, and we had decided we weren't going to take it anymore. Because you can imagine the mathematics. We would have one fight with one team. In our league, there would be 20. They've all had one each, but we've had 19 fights. So we would be thrown out.
Well, we used to have, we can say every season, we would have to either change our name. One, because we were successful, and one, it was all black and Asian team. We had one white player, really top, like a semi-pro player, and he played for us in the season. And to tell the truth, we won the league and everything, and he said, next year I can't play. I said, why is that? Because he used to take so much abuse that they say to him, you packy lover, what are you doing with them and this and that. And he said, I can't play for you no more, and that sort of thing. And that's what used to hurt us most.
I think generally, I mean, people came to Southall Youth Movement because some of them were living, I'd use the word, under siege, under terror, from constant racist attacks and police, these caring professionals. And children were involved, you know, traumatized. And I think people saw us as the guardians. Actually, as groups of young people, we often disliked each other. Like, we had a rivalry with the football team. There was a group from that side of Southall who hated the guys on this side of Southall.
My input was that these little groups we had in Southall, we sort of influenced them to come and join together and become as one group, rather than being smaller groups all over the place and sort of fighting against one another within the groups, and just unite and fight against discrimination that we were having at that time.
At that time, then our elders, the mother and fathers, they were feeling much safer to go out. Even at night time, they wanted to go there, go out, because there were more of us patrolling the streets and everything, making it safer for the younger kids to walk out and go and go to the park and play football.
We went to the golf link a couple of times. The families have been harassed there. The council didn't want to do anything. The police didn't want to do anything. You had to get a group of 20, 30 boys going and protecting the family's house. Once those people knew that these kids were going to fight back, it started to change a bit. The atmosphere sort of changed. Brick Lane in East London. We used to read or hear stories that on a Saturday afternoon, you had skinheads coming from one side of that road, smashing up the place and going, let's go packy bashing. We started going there to help those people. We started going to areas where all these problems were. And eventually those people got together as well then. They started to fight back. The first day I started a shop in Feltham, somebody just put a shutter through it, through the window, just because of my colour. So then you had to come down to Southall Youth Movement and tell them, look, this is happening. They would come there. They would get two or three of their membership, stay with me till 10 o'clock. That's what they done. They sort of backed you up. We had three Silmans in Southall and they were charging overprices. So what we done was the youth got together and we started demonstrating in front of all three Silmans run by the Asian community, Asian Silmans, and we told them, you have to reduce these prices or no one's going to go in there. So we wouldn't let the people, you know, we said, look, we're fighting for you. No one's going to see the films. They had to reduce the prices. Things like that, you know, the youth done for them.
It wasn't like the Black Panthers, which was much more overtly political and had a political program on a 10-point program and you could either agree or disagree to it. It wasn't that. It was a very Pacific, Southall-led, from the grassroots, from the community, a movement to tackle the issue of violent racism, whether it came from skinheads or the policing.
In a community, you need an organization who can speak, talk up to people on your behalf. And at that time, Southall Youth Movement was the only organization that would listen to what we had to say and do something about it.
If you don't have anything to lose, you're actually very free. And you can do things that I wouldn't dream of trying to do today. You know, we used to march into the... I remember once with Raj walking into the head of education's office and thumping down this piece of paper and saying, now read this, because you don't know anything about Southall, so read this, right, before I talk to you. I mean, I couldn't think of doing that today.
Our leaders at the time, we had meetings with the police and they were telling them off straight away in front of the public. And even the police didn't like that because they never saw anything like that.
A couple of weeks before that the local authority had decided in view of the pending local government elections that they were going to allow the National Front to have meet at in Southall Town Hall.
And the National Front had deliberately picked St. George's Day as a day for them for the, having the public meeting in Southall. There was no member of National Front in Southall, so it was going to be outsiders coming in, deliberately trying to provoke on an agenda of repatriating Asian blacks and anybody who was of color living in the country.
I remember sitting in my front room with many colleagues, and my father came in. This is before the event of meeting of the National Front. We all went silent because, you know, everybody respected the parent. All he said was, are you just going to talk or are you going to do something? I think for a couple of seconds, we were just looking at each other. And I remember one of my friends said, this is what they all think. There is no way that we are not going to do what we are going to do. We have to do something.
We had a demonstration of about 10,000 people on the Sunday before, and we marched from Southall through to Ealing Town Hall. And we were protesting basically to the council, but also trying to have a public presence on the street to try and get the Home Secretary to actually ban them meeting in the town hall. But that didn't happen. It was agreed that they would go ahead. But we had a fantastic demonstration, and we had not just people from the community, but obviously anti-racists and others came from outside the area.
People I know who worked in local factories all left the factories. There was effectively a political strike all around the area. Hayes, Southall, people left their factories, left their workplaces, shut their shops, and in their thousands came to the centre of Southall for a peaceful sit-down protest to stop the fascists coming. And all the police had to do was to say, "Sorry, fascists, not today. You can't really come to this area today," which they didn't do.
Our leaders, they had made it clear they were going to do this peaceful Gandhi-style sit-in. And their plan, you could see, wasn't going to work, because they thought they were going to somehow be allowed to sit in front or in the middle of a road, you know, high street, while this meeting was going to be happening. And you could see that the police weren't going to allow anywhere near the actual building. So obviously we decided the only way around is to dictate the whole day. So at about 12 o'clock, they started moving from our building. By the time they had gone to Southall Bridge, two or three people had been arrested. But the police insisted they could not stop at any one point. They kept moving them because they were told that if you stopped, they would be arrested. So what did the police arrested all those people wearing the steward bands.
Demonstration Southall de vich us time de vich mera khayal hai England di ek history gwaya 10,000 more than 10,000 ton te itthe demonstration hoi Southall de vich us din mera khayal bhi sari Europe ton England ton ki sari Europe da media itthe aa gaya ki Southall ch ki ho gaya eh youth kithon aa gaya kinne ikattha kar laye
the. The troubles began early as many of Southall's 30,000 nations, a fifth of the town's population, blocked off every road to the town hall. By now it was a town under siege. There was no access to the centre. Queues of policemen and police horses guarded each alleyway. Every shop was closed or boarded up. The demonstrators were told they had 1 minute to move off the streets or face arrest.
Why are you sitting across the road like this?
We are protesting against the National Front, because the police, they protect to the National Front. This is the main reason. They unnecessarily arrested our men.
They refused to leave, and the police moved in.
Go, move along now. Where are you, mate?
Right down the road.
At the end of the day, there were more than 300 arrests and many were injured. Among those injured were several policemen. The National Front was smuggled into the town hall through a back street, but no one, apart from the party faithful, were allowed inside with them. Keith Hatfield, News at 10 in Ealing.
My job was to kind of just take names and addresses and make sure that the police were aware. We had our marshal bands around, so, you know, the police knew that there were a few of us. But that very quickly, you know, it just kind of blew out of proportion, because I think by 1:30 I'd been arrested as well. I saw off the Broadway where the Burtons is, I saw there was a police cordon, and this very old Indian woman actually walked through because she lived on that road. She wanted to go into then. As soon as she went past the cordon, the police cordon, I absolutely saw this young police officer kick her, really. Asian woman, older than my mother at that time. And that's when I went and kind of got involved with the police officer. How dare you do that? I started pushing him around. The next thing I know, they arrested me.
I was partly there to make sure people were safe and also to see if anybody was being arrested, to take the details and make sure they knew that that they had our support. So that was largely the role I found myself in. And in the end, I found myself being more of a witness to abuse by the police and to people being arrested than actually being a steward, because in the end, they effectively stopped us from having our protest.
Some of the other guys, their plan was simple. If we burn the town hall, there can be no meeting, there will be no problem. So we said, no, no, that's not going to be done because it's an act of vandalism. The senior guys, some of the senior guys resisted, and 5-6 of them were arrested. This is Gurmail, Tarzan, and those people, you know, my friend, kind of Malkeet.
I was arrested that time. And even the police, they chased us on the road, on the footpath, with the vans. They didn't do nothing to them, but they chased us on the footpath. The police were trying to beat my friend up. As I jumped the line to help him out, and they arrested me.
A contingent decided that they needed to go through the police, and one way was taking a bus through them. So 207 comes along. The driver tried to drive off. He realized something was going, because this group of young people coming towards the driver. And he tried to speed off. Our friend there, the mechanic, he calmly went to the back and switched the engine off. The driver just legged it, and everybody piled into this bus.
I remember that suddenly the window of the bus just coming out. Boom. Mm-hmm. He just kicked the hell out of that window, and the window came right out. Mm-hmm.
I think, you know what it was, it's like we had a group of troublemakers from LSE.
Thank you very much.
Who said, do this, do that.
It's the most famous I've ever been. My picture was on the front page of the Guardian the next day.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The big face.
The police tactics on the day were also this, that they were what you would call cattling. Snatch squads, and actually provoking people. Well, all hell broke loose on the Broadway.
And I ended up on the Broadway around 4:30, 4:35. And by that time, what I witnessed was what could only be termed as an occupation by the police force in Southall. They'd occupied a small town. It had armored cars, it has police horses, and then 8 deep police officers with shields and helicopters. So it was a militaristic occupation of a town.
When the time came, we just sat on the outside the town hall, right? So we were all sitting down. This is in front of one of our law centres there. Southall Rights used to be there, and we were all sitting in front of it, and we were all just sitting around chatting and stuff. And then the National Front turned up, and the police decided to clear us. Oh, firstly, they sort of tried to clear us by baton charging. Okay. Now, you know, you get some policemen coming around with a truncheon in one hand and a shield in the other. It's pretty scary stuff, you know. So, but you know, the kids are also not going to back off, right? So we were also just standing our ground, right? And then what really let hell loose was they charged with horses. And then they were just indiscriminate. Then they were just, you know, the guy on the horse, and he was whacking like this.
I saw a priest who had an umbrella trying to help a woman who had fallen down, and the police arrested both the woman and the priest. By 6-7 o'clock, the police were out of control and we were facing an orgy of violence.
So we ran, actually, and we all ran. We ran from the town hall down back to this place that People's Unite had, this community center.
The wanton violence the police used on 6 Parkview. This is where Misty and Roots were set up. An eyewitness report says, and this is statements from everybody, including Eve Turner, who you've interviewed, the police went into 6 Parkview, a building called People's Unite Building. They threw everybody down the stairs, they beat them up, and when they came out, they had to suffer, bent down because of the gauntlet of police officers and being truncheoned.
They came inside the building and they destroyed most of the building and arrested a lot of people. A lot of the band members and everybody were taken out of the building and were falsely accused of things that they never did. The manager of our band was cushed inside 6 Parkview by the SPG. So they were going around cushing people. When I say cush, they were beating people with chongshan, heavy chongshan. Well, he nearly died. And he had fluid on the brains, you know, and fortunately he recovered.
They had their batons out and they started smashing us all over the head. So I was hit over the head. I then collapsed. I was taken to Ealing Hospital, where I had a very bad gash and I was stitched up. There were other people that were more seriously hurt. There were people who were unconscious, get up, and we were doing absolutely nothing other than just standing there trying to help people and obviously trying to find out what was going on. So that was quite a frightening experience to be attacked in that way when you're doing absolutely nothing.
Young little boy, a youth boy. I was running around all of Southall watching everything. But I remember when I was at Misty Roots house, Parkview, I was there, we had lawyers, most of the hospital people, everyone was there. And the police came, the SPG came, they started smashing the doors down. From the second, like the building was like 3-story high, from the second story, I was thrown out by our guys, thrown out, a couple of black Rastas grabbed me, told me, boy, run, gotta get out of here. I ran through Southall Park, it was Planet of the Apes. The coppers was on truncheons, beating people over there, licking them, just pow, pow, pow. But we had some brave soldiers fighting the policemen. Yeah, but I was only 14, young.
The band The Ruts was a part of the People's Unite. And even at that time, they had, I think, released a tune that can, you could say, be like coming from what actually happened in 1979, which is a tune called Jar Wars. Well, the poignant lyrics was Clarence Baker, which was the manager of Misty. So he says Clarence Baker was no troublemaker. The truncheon came down and whatever.
Clarence Baker, no troublemaker, said the truncheon came down, knocked him to the ground. See the blood on the streets that day, the blood and the madness. Said the blood on the streets that day. Yeah. Fighting, a Jawa.
I was arrested at around 6:45. I was taken to Southall Police Station. So I asked for a solicitor. I got a slap and saying I'd been watching too many American movies. And then I was taken to Watford and released from Watford.
I think the community were more shocked than anything about the level of aggression of the police that, you know, we were brought up to respect the police.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I think, I don't like the word riots. I always don't like, you know, it wasn't riots, it was protesting. You know, the connotation of riots is that it was something deliberate was done, and you link it up to, you know, what happened recently, you know, and where deliberate attempts were made to destroy property. Nothing like that ever happened in Southall. You know, it was always a protest for a cause, you know, so that was the difference.
In the Shakti bookshop for quite a long time, as well as other literature, we had some badges that sold incredibly well, which said, "Help the police, beat yourself up." We sold huge numbers of those things. A bit of gallows humour, I suppose, but it's easy to find people in Southall today who remember all of that and who are quite scarred by it in different ways, and who are still angry about it.
Everybody knows the killers of Blair Peach. They have closed ranks to protect them. So in my judgment, there is no kind of confusion. The killers are at large. They should be brought to justice.
It was quite shocking, and the very thought that, you know, he was a teacher from New Zealand, I remember, you know, and he had come out there to, you know, stand up against the National Front, you know, he was showing solidarity. You know, it was just a tragic way to go.
He was killed right next to his cha-cha's house, you know, right next door in the front garden. That's what the heartbreak thing was. When we went there 2 days later to see the front garden, I'll tell you what, the chill went through us. I looked at Chewie looked at me, and I was thinking, shit, hold on. He goes, but that's Jimbo's house. We knocked on Jimbo's. They were afraid to come out. And he said all we could hear was these coppers just laying into this bloke, screaming, shouting with their truncheons and everything.
Although there are 14 witnesses who see a police officer strike Blair Peach, 14, 13 of them are independent of Blair Peach, who've never met Blair, who live on Orchard Avenue or Beechcroft where they were killed. He discounts their theory and their evidence, and he creates this, what he says are only two extreme possibilities without any evidence. Firstly, that a left-wing activist killed Blair Peach to create a martyr. This is what he said to the jury. And the second is that nobody knows how Blair Peach came into his death. As far as the police were concerned, that was the end of the matter. Unfortunately for us, police officers commit crimes, they murder, they kill, they maim, they lie, and they are corrupt. And as soon as you're about to take action, they retire. So you can't take action legally against them.
We had a demonstration in this community. Over 10,000 people marched. His body was laid out in state in the Dominion Theatre, and the most incredible, touching display of emotion from our community in support of him and solidarity with him and his family.
उस टाइम असीं एक बहुत ही अच्छा community worker, comrade. ਜਿਹੜਾ ਬਲੇਅਰ ਪੀਚ ਹੈ ਅਸੀਂ ਗਵਾਇਆ ਅਸੀਂ ਹਮੇਸ਼ਾ ਨੂੰ ਸਲੂਟ ਕਰਦੇ
ਹਾਂ ਇਫ ਯੂ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਟੂ ਬੀਟ ਸਮਬਡੀ ਅਪ ਦੈਨ ਯੂ ਆਬਵੀਅਸਲੀ ਹੈਵ ਟੂ ਚਾਰਜ ਦੈਮ ਬਿਕਾਜ਼ ਅਦਰਵਾਈਜ਼ ਯੂ ਕੈਨਟ ਜਸਟੀਫਾਈ ਬੀਟਿੰਗ ਸਮਬਡੀ ਅਪ ਇਫ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਕਾਪਰ ਯੂ ਕੈਨਟ ਜਸਟ ਬੀਟ ਸਮਬਡੀ ਫਾਰ ਨੋ ਰੀਜ਼ਨ ਸੋ ਇਟ ਮਸਟ ਹੈਵ ਬੀਨ ਦੇਅਰ ਫਾਲਟ ਸੋ ਦੇ ਹੈਡ ਟੂ ਬੀ ਚਾਰਜਡ ਸੋ ਹੰਡਰਡਸ ਆਫ ਪੀਪਲ ਵਰ ਚਾਰਜਡ
42 ਪੀਪਲ ਗਾਟ ਅਰੈਸਟਡ ਐਂਡ ਚਾਰਜਡ. A special stipendiary court was set up in Barnet. We didn't even know where Barnet was. And it was a deliberate act by the kind of government and the state and the institutions to teach Southall a lesson. So a lot of people and a couple of my friends got sentenced. We supported their families weekly. That was our job. We paid for their kind of legal defense. We paid for their fines because it could have been me and the others. I was collecting everybody's kind of charge sheets and thinking, what did you get charged with? He's And he looked a bit serious, and I said, are you okay? He said, yeah, I've been charged. He said, what for? I said, what for? He said, assault. I said, that's minor, right? So that's not a problem. Give me your charge sheet. And he wouldn't give me the charge sheet. And I said, give me the charge sheet, man. He said, no, I'll sort it out myself. I said, no, you're not going to sort it out. We are going to sort it out for you. So I took the charge sheet out from his hand, and he had apparently assaulted a police dog. What had happened was he was being chased by the police. he was being chased by the police, and he hid under a car.
Oh, I know the case.
Yeah, he was the only one who assaulted a dog, right? So he has a special place in our history. And so they couldn't find him, so they let the dogs loose. And it was an Alsatian. And what he was prepared for everything, everybody was. So because everybody knew there was going to be dogs and all sorts, right? So he took, he had a packet of chili powder. He rubbed it against the dog's nose. The dog went berserk, so he got charged for that.
Curry
bomb. Yeah, like curry bomb.
There were two committees. There was a defence committee, which was to organise the legal representatives and so on. And then we had an actual campaign committee. And we just had fantastic support and funds in order to wage a campaign and to be able to have a legal campaign also to defend people from the arrest. Because effectively, the community was criminalised by actually arresting so many people, and lots of people's livelihoods were affected by the fact that they had been arrested and charged with a criminal offence.
And then we launched this campaign called Support the Southall 342. The Southall Youth Movement had organised a meeting. In fact, I remember going to a meeting which Balraj and Sunil Sinha were at Manor House, where all the lawyers turned up. And these lawyers were divided into different areas and who they would defend.
So we then started to organize them in incidents. And we gave one incident to one lawyer so that they could actually learn from each other. And that worked brilliantly because the amount of times the policemen contradicted each other.
There was one case I remember very well where somebody had got convicted for some petrol bomb incident, I think it was, or something like that. And he got sentenced, right? And then later there was another hearing. And because we had this database, we were able to prove that this officer, he had been claiming to be at two places at the same time. So which led to, the chap being acquitted and the first chap also, being acquitted.
We did manage to mount a series of very successful defences that led to the acquittal of very many people because of the way in which those defences were organised, the evidence gathered, and the defences then mounted in court, and the way too in which the Southall community came to Barnet. They came, they sat in the gallery. We would not have had that community defence without the Southall Youth Movement. There are many people who are much better qualified than I to talk to you about that, but I can say that it shaped a whole generation of lawyers and of subsequent community defences.
Every one of us wanted to and was going to burn the Hambrough Tavern down.
Another provocation, against the Southall community was a racist band, I think the Foreskins or something, and they had been booked to perform at the Hambrough Tavern.
The landlord of the Hambrough Tavern was asked many times by the community to stop them coming there, but the landlord wasn't listening to anybody.
I remember I was about 13 at that time. I'll never forget that day. Friday. Knocked on Chewy's door. I used to live at 85, Chewy's at 82. Come on, Chewy, let's go, son. Going to the club. He goes, all right, let me just tell my mum. Don't worry, come on. Kids, we heard this crash. Ran up to the top of the road, and all we see is a trolley had been thrown through the Maharaja window. cash and carry at the top of the road. And the lady had her arm cut up, auntie we used to call her. And all we see is these coaches just driving by and just skinheads with Mohicans and showing their backsides to us, giving us the finger and packy chanting. And one coach, two coaches, three, four, flipping out, what's going on here? And it was just a lot of noise, like a football pitch noise was going on. So we're looking all around. And I remember, and me and Chewie were at the top of Townsville, I remember from Trinity Road, some bloke, Indian bloke, just came running over. And he hurled, must have been a brick at this coach. And it went through the window, and that was it. All you could hear, you packy, this, that, and that. I looked at Chewie, Chewie looked at me, and we had a grin on his face. Okay, something's going to kick off here. So the next thing we knew, we was like, Chewie said, I'm going home. I said, I'm going to stick around. Sticking around, all we could see is behind us this community of people, Indians, just forwarding towards the Hambrough Tavern, towards the left of us. And I looked at Chewie, I said, Chewie, let's go. And you know what? Every shop owner was just shutting shop and just walking towards that way. Police just came from nowhere, just trying to move us. They wouldn't have it. Chanting National Front, the skinheads were behind the police. We was on this end. From opposite, I remember this blatantly, from the opposite, the Hambrough Tavern, Ruskin Road, Stanley Road, Livingston Road, Tudor Road, all the way, flats. In front of them was a brick wall about 4 foot high. I remember somebody, we just started kicking this, the bricks down. Then all of a sudden, all these bricks and everything were hurled towards the police and everything. And I could hear them in Indian saying, we're not going to let this go. Everybody was at it. You know, and then all of a sudden, there was a petrol station there. They kicked in the petrol station. I remember this green police van was over that side, behind us, to the right-hand side, because there used to be an ATC centre that was there. Police were everywhere, but by the time us guys and everybody that was there, the police had gone back. We pushed them back. And everybody was determined, we're going to set this bastard on light. How dare they have this in our community? You know, a couple of years ago, they beat up Blair Peach, killed him. We have to stand up. Remember, I couldn't speak a word of Indian, but I could hear them and understand what they were saying, and that the atmosphere was, this is it. Either they're going to die or we're going to die. You know, it was the line was drawn, and all of a sudden, a petrol bomb went over. I think, oh, shit. Chewie, run. Splurted everywhere. It was like, and it was just chaos. Police were just trying to push us and everything else. Blatantly, we saw this. As soon as that petrol bomb went over, the police forced us on the bridge downwards up to about Beresford Road, and we could see all the skinheads just running the opposite direction. Few of them were there standing, saying, come on, you, this, that, and then people just started hurling bricks and everything. Police couldn't do nothing.
And of course, the point is, you know, at that point, you don't know if your job is actually to cool them down or to get involved, you know. So the main idea was that, you know, okay, we'll keep trying to cool it down. But there was no way of cooling it down. By the time we got there, the place was in flames. You know, and the kids were hopping mad, you know.
You know what? My heart was pounding, thinking, shit, this is it, man. This is something you don't see. The place was ablaze and everybody was still out there saying, let's have them, let's do the police and everything else. Because we were standing ground. It was a proud moment. We stood up for ourselves, saying we're in Southall. Yes, all right, it's full of Indians. Full of Indians, but we stood up for ourselves and went forward and done what we had to do. Next morning, I went out there. I was looking at, remember, the petrol station at the top of our road, jet petrol station. Police helmets up there. People were up there trying to get them down. It's just chaos. Cars were turned off upside down. I remember getting on my bike, just cycling up there. The Hambrough Town was shredded down. Nothing. The wall along the right, left, there was nothing left of it. People were out. The press were out. Cameras. I just wanted to go and see the devastation.
And next day, it was a shrine of celebration. The number of older people that went there, proud of what had happened.
National Front nu te mera khayal hai vi hath khade karne pe gaye Southall di. Especially 1981 to baad, unna ne kadi muh nahi kita idhar fir.
If I'm going to Southall, I would have to look in that direction. Southall Youth Movement, it's not there, but it's a memory, it's a part of us. Our symbol still sits there.
that, you know, the youth movement gave us the voice which our parents would have probably said, no, you know, be quiet. But because the Southall Youth Movement gave us a voice that allows our children to walk free. So the story sounds like Martin Luther King and all these.
That's what actually happened to Southall. Southall changed after that. It got much more confident of who they were and what it was about.
It opened doors for other organizations to form, including Southall Black Sisters. It became a beacon for many other communities. Youth movements mushroomed across the country, in Bradford, in Manchester, in Sheffield, in other parts of London. And also, other communities began to respect the Asian community. And it broke the stereotypes that Asians are just simply passive. It exposed and defeated currents like the National Front.
One of the successes, in my view, of the progressive movement at that time, as represented by the Southall Youth Movement, was that it had a cultural dimension, it had a community dimension, it had a professional dimension, it had a political dimension.
I think the events of April 79 have international and national significance on policing, on racism, on community self-defense, and notions of accountability of when police are out of control. Had we learned those lessons in 1979 and 80s, we wouldn't have the scandals that we've experienced in relation to Stephen Lawrence or Mark Duggan.
Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has and it never will. The Southall Youth Movement made that demand, and they were right to do so.
We always say this, you know, the past informs the present and the present shapes the future. You cannot forget the history of Southall. You cannot forget the history of your own community. That's how it works. So for the children and the next generation, we are part of them. They are part of us. They cannot and should not disconnect from our experiences.
What do you really know about the area you were born and raised in? How do you represent something without knowing the history, culture, politics, and struggles of the people? I want to tell you where I'm from, and for that, I only really have one question.
Who killed Blair Peach? My town still needs to know. Justice never stood a chance against policing codes. A lone teacher from New Zealand left his beast exposed. Now they're speaking codes to leave us seeking feeble quotes. Refuse the answers but seducing us to feed them votes. A generation's past and still unite to scream and no. 5 miles from Heathrow to see my seeds grow. Increase the peace slow, we never cease to preach, bro. This is the town that told the National Front to step behind. Extending braces but we're nameless when you cross the line. Like facing pagans on their playgrounds in the sands of time. Now my vision's made to burn the hate, I'm walking colorblind. This is the town that held their breath and swam the rivers of blood. The face of Enoch Powell's nightmares, we ruptured the flood. The Southall Black Sisters, Broadway and the Glossy Junction. This is the town that built a commonwealth of mass confusion.